Mr. Christo Els, the senior partner of Weber Wenzel. Weber Wenzel Partners present. Corporate Social Investment Partners. Members of the African Legal Aid Network. Weber Wenzel staff, esteemed guests, I greet you all. It really is a great privilege and honor to have been invited to say a few words at this auspicious occasion, marking the launch of this impressive new building, which is no doubt an architectural masterpiece. I've been passing around here wondering, how possible is it for a firm of attorneys to occupy a building so grand? So thank you very much for inviting me. Time is limited, and maybe I should just go straight to the point. I see it as a sign of confidence in the future of South Africa that Weber Wenzel decided to build a building so special, a building so magnificent. Because no doubt it's only when you are confident, when you are convinced that there is a brighter tomorrow, that you can take a step so bold. I see this great firm of attorneys. Oh, George, I didn't see you. Good evening. As a think tank. Not just for the firm itself and its clientele, but a think tank for South Africa, a think tank for Africa. An ocean of experience, skill, and the wisdom we need to chart the way forward for our country. A few remarks I am going to make are inspired by the letter of invitation that Mr. Els sent to me. This is what he said in the first paragraph. He said, I'll change it just a little bit. As a firm, we continue to actively contribute meaningfully towards safeguarding the basic values which bind us all and underpin our constitutional democracy. And this was followed by yet another letter to provide some guidance in relation to which topics I need to touch on. And he said, I should consider touching on the rule of law as the cornerstone of our democracy, how far South Africa has come, our roles as individuals, corporates, a law firm to achieve the goals of the Constitution and our democracy. It is only when firms of attorneys like Weber Wenzel genuinely embrace the constitutional mandate placed on all of our shoulders, individually and collectively, that we can become what we all promise to become, that we can do what we all promise to do in the preamble to our Constitution. And that is the challenge to Weber Wenzel in the letter of invitation, but also the challenge to all of us. When this great firm of attorneys sees it as its responsibility to contribute to the transformation of the attorney's profession, the academia, the advocate's profession, and the judiciary, not leaving behind society as a whole. Then and only then are we going to make meaningful progress. I begin with the rule of law. We will never be able as a nation to promote the observance of the rule of law and have those who lead us commit to the observance of the rule of law if we haven't done the necessary spadework. And the necessary spadework is ensuring that we have a crop of attorneys, advocates, and lawyers who are in the academic field properly grounded in their area of operation with the necessary forensic skills so that we have a readily available pool out of which to appoint competent judicial officers. Because it is only when they are competent that nobody can dictate to them what to do and what or what not to do for their own convenience. It takes a well-grounded legal practitioner who is then appointed to judicial office to say no when she has to say no, and yes only when the yes is justified in the sense that it accords with his or her constitutional and legal responsibilities. So, open your arms much wider to welcome, over and above what you have done already, more of the previously disadvantaged South Africans. I've had the pleasure of having law clerks from this firm. I must say you train them well. We need, I think, I hope Sarah is here. Sarah McKenzie is one of them. We need lawyers like Sarah and many others that I was privileged to work with, afforded the opportunity to develop their forensic skills so that when they make themselves available for high judicial office, ultimately, our constitutional democracy can truly be guaranteed. But I need to appeal to everybody in the House, whether you're an attorney, an advocate, or a business person. We have a collective responsibility in line with a preamble to our Constitution to make sure that all of our people have their potentials freed. And that will only happen when we do not pretend to embrace transformation, but when we genuinely, without anybody breathing down our necks from time to time, embrace the need to transform the legal profession. Maybe before I go any further, let me share with you the message that I received today. If you don't know Afrikaans, Mr. Els will interpret for you. Just so that this point is put in a proper perspective. An acquaintance of mine, Mr. Tiens Krier, sent me a text yesterday, and it reads, "Moore Mogoeng, hoop dit gaan goed met julle. Ek stuur die stekkie vir jou miskien ter verkoming van die onreg wat tans besig is om te gebeur. Groete Tiens." But this is the stekkie that he sent. Oh my goodness, I must take my glasses. It is a quotation by Dr. Adrian Rogers. He wrote this piece in 1931. I quote, "You cannot legislate the poor into freedom by legislating the wealthy out of freedom. What one person receives without working for, another person must work for without receiving. The government cannot give to anybody anything that the government does not first take from somebody else. When half of the people get the idea that they do not have to work because the other half is going to take care of them, and when the other half gets the idea that it does no good to work because somebody else is going to get what they work for, that, my dear friend, is about the end of any nation. You cannot multiply wealth by dividing it." Tiens means well, but he probably thinks, and genuinely so, that when you talk transformation, you have in mind the promotion of some entitlement syndrome. Give me, give me, give me without having to sweat for it. I want to dispel any possible perception that that's what I'm asking for when I talk about the empowerment of the previously disadvantaged in the attorney's profession and the advocate's profession. The reality is, the preamble to our Constitution says that we've got to recognize the injustices of the past, and also that South Africa belongs to all who live in it, united in our diversity. What is indisputable is this, and I'm answering your questions, by the way. Before we became a constitutional democracy, South Africa was made to look like it belonged only to some, but not all. When we chose to put aside the few things that divided us, and that had been dividing us over so many years, and focus our energies and collective wisdom on the many things that unite us, in 1994, we made a commitment to do everything humanly possible, black and white, men and women, to make South Africa truly look like it belongs to all South Africans. It is a necessary commitment because it seeks to deal a permanent blow to all the things that caused us to be a nation at war with itself. All the things that caused us to be divided can only be destroyed permanently if we do not pretend to have embraced the idea of a rainbow nation, if we do not pretend to be committed to giving practical expression to what Madiba, bitter as he ought to have been, chose to embrace and devote the better part of his life as a free man doing, and that is uniting all South Africans across the color divide, reconciling South Africans across the color divide, helping all of us to realize that it really is a foolish thing to do, to seek to discriminate and disadvantage others just because of color or gender. So we owe it to ourselves, but more importantly, we owe it to our innocent children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren who have nothing to do with the divisions of the moment to prepare a better tomorrow out of South Africa. Because as Alan Payton said, our country is truly beautiful. As you know, this is how he put it. He said, but your country is beautiful. It really is. Our country is amazingly well endowed with mineral resources. It's incredibly beautiful, an excellent tourist attraction. If we choose to focus on the many things that ought to bring us together and put aside the trivialities of race and gender, put aside the past and focus on the brighter tomorrow that is exemplified or that is announced loud and clear by this magnificent building, then everybody, I believe, has the possibility to enjoy a decent life without depending on handouts. So the starting point I implore all of you is to examine our briefing patterns, our instructions giving patterns. All of us as South Africans, have they changed ever since apartheid died, or are they the same? If they are basically the same, then there is a problem. I was asked to go and by the Chief Justices of Asia in Australia during the course of last year to deliver a paper on unconscious bias. And I was obviously forced to do a bit of research. You'll be amazed that most of us believe that we don't have racial prejudice at all. And for as long as that is the position, then we have no problem to solve. Let me give you another example, and I'll talk about racism. We need to kill that thing. I had a friend in the Mafikeng area. I'm a part-time farmer, so I became so close to your hand. We drank murkofi together. We conversed, even if my Afrikaans is challenged in Afrikaans. We ate together. I visited his home. We were friends for all intents and purposes. But there is a development that opened up my eyes to the danger of unconscious bias, unconscious racism. We were talking and he kept on saying, James, 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 and his wife said, Skati, vias James. He said, James, as a kaffer wat vir my goeie werk. I was stunned. I was still the judge president over there in Mafikeng. I could never have suspected that Johan was capable of saying of a black person kaffer. And that was around 2008, deep into the constitutional democracy that we are. I bid him and his wife farewell and went home frustrated and I think bleeding. A measure of anger crept in. He called me in the evening and said, Mogoeng, ek hoop daar is geen misverstand nie. I said, no, Johan, daar is geen misverstand. Ek is Musaka vir regter president. But upon further reflection, I realized that racial prejudice, unconscious prejudice, does not require an emotional response. It does not require a blow-by-blow engagement. It requires a deep appreciation of the reality that as South Africans, we never really give ourselves time to address this problem. We mistakenly assumed that because we have one of the most progressive constitutions in the world, it is going to cause all the prejudices we used to harbor against each other, even hatred, to disappear automatically. That was a mistake. The question is, how then do we make sure that those who have never been afforded the opportunity to make a brutal self-introspection and connect with the reality that they still entertain unconsciously bias or racism, what is it that can be done? I think the time for dialogue has come. We need as many platforms as possible for those who think that, these people, black people are lazy, white people are bad people, to come and ventilate their frustrations and anger. Because out of that, a diagnosis of the rationale behind our inexplicable prejudices against each other or towards each other could be fished out, and the basis for a lasting solution would be found. Otherwise, we're fooling ourselves, because America has been a constitutional democracy for a long time, and many European countries have been. But what is going on? When African players go there, they are shown bananas. People are not bad. It's not because they are intrinsically bad. There is a problem, and that problem is unconscious bias. It is unconscious racism. And because people have not afforded themselves the opportunity to realize they have a problem, there is nothing to solve. There is nothing to address. We owe it to the beauty and the treasure that South Africa is. We owe it to the many hungry people in the rest of Africa, whose future depend on stability, unity, and reconciliation in South Africa, whose future depend on sustainable economic development having to kick in South Africa first before they can be positively impacted by the good that is happening here. Believe it or not, people in the rest of Africa are looking towards South Africa with great expectation. Show us that a constitutional democracy can work in Africa. So as you develop those article clerks, as you bring in more women as partners, more black people as partners, they spread out from South Africa as ambassadors of constitutionalism throughout Africa. They can even be appointed as judges there, because there are many judges in Africa now who don't even have legal qualifications. I went to Washington, D.C. to address the World Bank, and some people were connecting with us via, is it Skype or whatever? I'm challenged in terms of IT. Judges were connecting with us and saying, how can we manage our work? We have not received any legal training, and they are judges. It is the good that great law firms like this does that will transform South Africa in the manner that it ought to be transformed, that would change the negative mindset that people have about predominantly white law firms, that will help unite South Africans. I said earlier that you are a think tank, not just for your firm, but for South Africa. It is great firms like this that can say, wait a minute, there's been a problem lingering around us for far too long in relation to the land issue. Nobody should impose any solution on the people of South Africa. What is the best way of addressing this problem in a manner that will not give rise to tensions? Because we have had more tensions than we can handle. A strategy that you can sell to the rest of South Africa, to government. You are people of influence in your interactions with government and leaders in society. As thought leaders, you can influence the direction to be taken to address issues that used to divide us in the past, and the land issue is one of them. We always have two choices. To pretend, in fact, more than two, to pretend that there is no problem, a serious problem, when in fact there is, like the land issue, or to resort to spin doctoring. It is only the government that can solve. It is not true. We all have the responsibility to address the problem, to calm the tempers down, to look for a more viable way of solving our problems. You deal with the business community. That engagement must have enriched or deepened your understanding about economic issues. What is it that can be done to open the markets to all South Africans? The exclusivity of the past needs to be broken. What is it that can be done without bringing about unnecessary anger, bringing South Africans, black and white, at loggerheads with one another? You are the brains that can provide that solution. Where there is resistance to employment equity, as thought leaders, influential people, attorneys, advocates, people in the academia, lawyers in the corporate sector, it is within your power to betray South Africa by not doing what you are capable of doing, but to come up with solutions which you know people will respect and save our country that you and I belong to, or that belongs to you and I, from going back to the tensions of the past. So we need to find ways to address racism. People respected us all over the world because of the miracle that our constitutional democracy is. And in case you doubt, I think my time is up, in case you doubt our capacity, our determination when we trigger it into action to resolve serious problems, as I often say to people, cast your mind back to the early 1990s. I kept on saying, and I'll keep on saying, when President de Klerk said political prisoners are going to be freed and political organizations in exile are going to be unbanned, I said, this is a trap, this is a fluke. It's not possible. Because the tensions were just too high. The hatred was so thick, you could hold it. But he meant it. The negotiations started. Unthinkable. And when the AWB stormed the building where the negotiations were held, I said, I always knew that it will never materialize. This is South Africa. It got worse when Chris Hani got killed. I said, it's over, finally over. But South Africans have the resilience that you can only find in South Africa. The resilience that you can only locate in the hearts of South Africans. If we could solve that problem, what problem can we not solve? So I'm here, Mr. Els, appreciative of the platform you have given me to basically say we've come a long way and we dare not allow anything that divided us in the past to survive. We owe it to this country and to posterity to do everything humanly possible to effectively, I like your expression though, you say meaningfully, to meaningfully contribute and actively contribute to the elimination of the serious problems of the past, not to babysit women and black people in terms of instruction given by the big companies or the advocates, but simply seeking to recognize the injustices of the past, to heal the divisions of the past, to contribute towards improving the quality of life of all citizens, and release their potential. It is an obligation that nobody imposed on us. We have imposed that obligation on ourselves through the preamble to our constitution. This is Africa Day, and we Africans seated here, or we are not seated, we are standing. Seated and standing. I honestly, from the depth of my heart, implore you, I beg of all of us to interrogate ourselves, to do an introspection and see if we perhaps do not have some hidden prejudice lurking somewhere. Let me tell you about myself. I was in a foreign land. We were about to enter. I left with the officials from my office. And there were black and white people there. And I only greeted black people. Guilt crushed me afterwards. I said, why did I not greet all human beings in the lift? Why did I greet only white people? One of them said, you know, when you greet them, you see, when you greet them, they don't respond. Not long thereafter, a white lady came in and said, hi, everybody. Unconscious bias. Let's seek to find out if it is there, and the pointer to its existence is how you relate to people from another race, how you relate to women, because women are discriminated in a big way, even now. How do you relate to them? Has anything changed, marginally or profoundly? So I look forward to more bursaries, Mr. Els. I know that you sponsor some 12 students every year to the tune of 30,000 rands. It's good progress. I've seen the partnership is shaping up. There are women, there are black people. A lot of work still needs to be done. I appreciate the pro bono work that you are doing, ensuring that the underprivileged also have access to justice. That is to be encouraged. Share it with those who do not have similar programs so that our country can become even better. I can't say any more than please, please, please. Together let us kill racial prejudice. Together let us condemn damage to schools, damage to universities, damage to any property. We watch this on the news. It gets reported about. Nobody seems to be speaking out strongly against the destruction of our much needed assets, our schools. We need to shoulder the responsibility to make South Africa a better country. It is not the exclusive responsibility of government. Thank you ever so much for inviting me.